There you go. I've never opened one of these water bottles in all these many years.
Are you kidding me?
In terms of this, I almost never drink during the interview.
Oh, I see what
I always think
saying.
I'm going to.
No, I thought you meant in your human
life. No, not in human life.
Your life as a human.
That was a really good movie, so it was a good interview. But anyway.
What movie?
It was Michael Clayton.
Oh, it was, what a great... I mean, that's my... I think that's my... That's a great, great movie.
Yeah.
And it's my personal favourite of the many, many films of George Clooney. That's...
Yeah.
I think Michael Collins is, you know, fantastic. Michael Clayton?
Michael Clayton,
yeah, yes. Pardon me. I do that often.
Michael Collins, there's actually...
Yes, the old IRA yes. operative played by Liam Neeson.
Which we shot Liam
before.
Neeson for... The Gray.
Oh, yeah, the movie with the wolves. The circling wolves, yes.
He says, you know, the most important movie in my career was Michael Collins because it was about my country and about where I come from.
Oh, yeah.
Second movie, The Gray. Third movie, Schindler's List.
That's a man that's doing a good job for his film.
He's
good
all for about him. Perspective.
Good for him.
So, the basic idea of this is chat. So, we're kind of in that mode
no,
already.
No, we're there. I figured you might have already started and we were doing it.
Yeah, pretty much. The light is on you. So, you in America, to us, you came to us as a grown-up.
Yeah.
But you were actually a kid actor, I'm amazed to find.
I've been going since the beginning of, basically beginning of my teens, yeah.
So what is it that got you into being an actor as a kid?
There was a friend of mine who rang up and told me that there was an ad in the paper, they were looking for kids for this television series. And I took it as an easy subject in school,
mm-hmm.
did a play, the play went very well, I got a lot of, I got a lot of love for it. And then this, you know, my best friend rang me up and said, hey, I saw this. And I was, you know, me and the buddies that I was doing it with
mm-hmm.
were all going to write in and go. And so I wrote in, la la, and I was coming near the day and I said, guys, we're going to do this. And they were like, and none of them had written in. And but so then I just thought, I might as well.
Mm.
And I went along and got that, you know, that thing. I don't think I would have, it wasn't something I was, always wanted to do or anything like that. I doubt I would have kept going, kept trying.
So did you just get kind of work thrown at you from there on, or did you?
Yeah, I did. One of the first things I did was a children's miniseries, and that shot for 6 months.
Mm.
And I was really worried at the midpoint there that, you know, I wouldn't work again. So I just tried. I tried to learn whatever I could because, it was. It's a great thing to do when you're young. I think it's not a great thing to have to depend on, but it was. It was fantastic. I mean, they were really golden days.
Did you know what you were doing as an actor?
No. I mean. You know, ish. I mean, there's always a sense of ish about when you are acting. You know, you feel like you more or less know what you're doing, and then there are parts of it which you can always sort of do more in or differently or this or that or the other. But I didn't know what I was doing in a good way most of the time, insofar as... you know, there were moments where I think things came through. I mean, I think it was probably pretty bad, most of what I did. But I imagine that there would have been... Well, I know, I've seen it. There were moments where, that came alive then.
So did it change? Did you find a process or get more serious about it?
Yeah, I think you go through... you seem to... go through stages where you feel like you know what it is you're supposed to do, and then you do that until you, I guess, find something else or find something deeper or something better, hopefully. And then you sort of move towards that for a while, and then, you know, so it seems to be something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a mixture always, I think, of knowing and not knowing what you're doing. Because I think you try. That's all you do. You do takes and you try something. And then you try that something again and again and again. And hopefully something in there is good and gets used.
So you never became a student or a...
No, I thought about it. I thought about it. But I'd left school... 14, really, was when I started acting. And I didn't go back to school. I went for a tiny little bit, but it just didn't... It had all changed. So I left school quite young. And one of the requirements for entry into the acting schools was that you had to have... you know, completed what for us is like middle school. You know, I hadn't. So that was that. It was a bit. Also, I was working.
Right.
And that's a really good school, if you got good people.
So did Year My Voice Broke, which you got awards for and things, was that a game changer? Was that, or did it feel like a process?
Yeah, Year My Voice Broke was a game changer. I was very fortunate in the first years of my working life that no one really gave a, you know, I was just a dude that sort of got work.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, I didn't have any, there was no pressure. There was no expectational sort of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'd had a couple of years under my belt by the time Year My Voice Broke happened. And then I became... known and thought of, I guess, in film terms that started. Before that, it was purely, you know, in television terms and in a very limited way.
And then you were, is there such thing as a Australian movie star? Is that
It's a relative term. I mean, it's a relative term. I don't think that's what I is. And there is such a thing, but most of them you'd be aware of in one way or another or would have had some exposure to.
Mm-hmm.
But I worked quite a bit in that next sort of period and, you know, did leads in films and that kind of business.
And were you business savvy? Were you like, become ambitious or?
I knew what I didn't want to do. You know, I knew there were the things that I didn't want to do and I had an idea. I think... it's really just about who you admire as a child and a teenager growing up. And if you've got, you know, if you've got good sort of idols or they've got something about them, then you just try and emulate, really. You just try and sort of do what and adopt the sort of the mores of them. And that was, you know, that was pretty much the case.
Well, you seem to have worked with pretty much everybody, all the Australian actors who we've seen come over here over those years. But you didn't seem to have that... or maybe you did have that ambition to come to Hollywood as many of them did.
No, mine, I sort of dipped my toe in the 90s. I came over once or twice. And then I didn't start doing it in earnest until the 2000s. I mean, it's very hard to... it's a tough place to make a living... if you want to do more than just sort of subsist well. And I figured that, you know, if I wanted to try and make a living at it, then it was LA or it was England. And LA seemed the more obvious choice for a lot of reasons. So I started coming over in earnest in the early 2000s.
And do you like it here? Is it...
Oh, I liked a lot of it. I mean, I had a lot of friends here. So it always felt good. And no one knew me here. And that was nice, too, because, you know, there's no sort of... It was sort of like fresh in that way. And that went on for a while where it was like that. And then it became a real... just a, you know, a sort of an uphill battle for a while because I came for many, many years with no... with nothing. Absolutely nothing to show for it, really. So it became an article of some kind of faith or just because it didn't seem like anything else smarter to do. So it was just a case of keeping going, really.
So was there a some sort of specific change between you as, I mean, your movies of you as a teenager and in your early 20s, it seems like almost a different person. I mean, I recognize you and I hear your voice, but it seems like really a kid. And then there seems a point where all of a sudden there's like this, the actor and the person, the adult that we come to know.
Well, there's probably a fair bit of television and some theater and stuff in there, which would have, you know, sort of made that less of a gap. But, but I think there was a definite period where, for whatever reason, it didn't work, you know, it just wasn't happening. Mm-hmm. That changed, obviously. I mean, look, it's Animal Kingdom. Without Animal Kingdom, none of the stuff following it, with the possible exception of Killing Them Softly, happens. None of it.
So did you know when you guys were on Animal Kingdom
absolutely
that something
not.
Was happening?
No, absolutely not. Absolutely not. Mm. I think we, well, I mean, I'm not a very good, I don't have any perspective on that stuff when I'm in it. I find that, so I don't know.
Do you judge your work well at all? I mean, do you ever go, yeah, that worked, or that was terrible?
I can feel bits that I think are, you know, that, yeah, I can feel bits when it works, but I, you know, and I'm aware of the bits that I feel would have been a bit better like this or a bit better like that, but... Mm. Yeah, I can feel it when it works.
And how much do directors play into what you bring to the set?
I mean, an enormous amount. And but it's not just the directors. The set is it's sort of everyone there. I mean, the set is, it's like carnival folk. That's the way I think of crews and cast. We are kind of carny folk, and the only question is, are we upmarket carny folk or are we downmarket carny folk? And that depends too. But that family feeling that you hopefully get when you go and shoot a film and stuff like that, that vibe is really the super important one. And the director is the director of that. You know, he is the helmsman. But the first assistant director is crucial. And it's not something, I think it's a very insider kind of a thing, but the mood that's set, the way that goes, but that's up to sort of everyone. But that plays a huge part in how well I do or don't.
So ultimately your performance is really affected by the vibe.
Well, yeah, and I do a lot of things to try and make sure that that's going to be okay, you know, that vibe. So that vibe, when you're doing theatre and you've got an audience, you can feel them. And you know when you've got, you know, you can feel when it's going well and when it's not. Mm. The difficulty in with camera stuff is you don't have that same interaction. So... there are certain ways of unlocking yourself, I think, you know, going from just a guy being in a room to a guy that can all of a sudden start crying or doing whatever it is. And that's what I try and do, just that, clear the space enough and make it so we can do it.
So are your selections of what you do partially based on whether you think you can... make that happen with the...
No.
Or do you have choice? You don't even feel like you have choice yet. A lot of actors who, you know, we talk to who are significantly successful but still feel like they're kind of jobbing actors and...
Yeah, well, it's a nice thing to hold on to the idea of being a jobbing actor, because it keeps it, you know, it keeps it in a good place, in a good perspective. But, no, I'm starting to get choice. You know, I mean, for a very long time, that hasn't been the case at all. But, then, you know, there have been little periods where I've had, you know, more choice than less. But that's not, no, the things you go for when you decide are the reading, the feel, what you feel from the script, and then the form guide, you know, who's going to be in the race. Or, you know, and if it's a... great director and a great actor or a great movie star or something like that, and you think, oh, yeah, this might work. But that's basically it. You read it, hope that you respond, and then you attempt to, you know, evaluate chance of success.
So does a picture like Dark Knight different for you? I mean, you're...
It'd been a long time since I'd done an enormous sort of studio film, and, mm-hmm. and it's fair to say I'd never done one that size before.
But I mean, few people have.
I mean,
that's a big movie.
Yeah, I guess you're right. But that's just a slam dunk. I was in the midst of shooting Killing Them Softly, and my agent asked me to go on tape for it. And I'd never gotten a job off tape in my life. I thought it was essentially, it was just, you know, a myth and a waste of time. She kept at me about it, and mm-hmm. and you know, and thank God she did. And I put something down, and then, you know, and then I got a call, you've got that job. So, I mean, there's no question at that stage. I mean, that's, yeah, you don't look at that and go, oh, well, is this, you know, some things are such a slam dunk, and
right.
particularly where I, you know, where one is, that it's just like, whoa.
Though it's interesting because it's kind of, in some ways, it's one of your least interesting roles.
Oh, yeah.
For this run. I mean, you've had some great characters and great performances, and then it's kind of like the rich guy.
Oh, it's very dry. I mean, you know, and that may, I mean, that, you know, it's hard for me to judge that, like to judge it. But I think that it's a very, you know, he's corporate and he's like, you know, I was sort of trying to channel my impression of a Wall Street type of dude. Mm. And yeah.
So in something like Killing Them Softly, which I happen to adore, and thought Dominic, actually my favorite Dominic movie at this point.
Right, cool.
But obviously didn't do any business in the United States.
No.
So the world has this judgment of it, but did you feel the reaction of the community to the work you did
in
that?
Very much. And I mean, more so outside of the US than inside the US. I mean, inside the US, it's not visible in a meaningful way at all. But outside it's a lot more visible. And, you know, it's got many ardent fans, that film. People love that film. And, I'm very proud of what we did. I think Scoot was just a... you know, such a gift of an actor to be able to work with doing that.
So does each film, I mean, what is your relationship with the film after you're done? Are you...
I try
done,
and so leave them.
Out?
Yeah, pretty much. I figure that it was when I was doing theatre that I sort of, you know, came to the view that, well, you never get to see the play that you're doing, but you get a sense of where it is and where it should be.
Mm-hmm.
And I sort of, you know, I just stopped, and then mm-hmm. I just didn't watch them anymore, and that, you know, that was that. Now, I have seen a few of them at you know, like festivals and stuff like that, when it would be like a big deal to sort of walk out. It's not about that. It's just I don't think about them then. You know, then they're done. I accept the the one nightness of it.
So when
it's permanent.
So when you do catch yourself, is it uncomfortable or is
it's not a tick. It's sort of right. just more of a decision that I've been doing this for, 30 odd years now, more than 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I know, you know, I've seen myself plenty of times, and I know, you know, I know what I'm doing, you know, I know what it is, you know, I know the bits about it that I go, oh, but you can't do much about it. In reality, you are the person you are, and... Mm-hmm. Some of the things, you know, I've tried to do, and I think they came away. But after a while, it was just a case of, well, you know, this is going well. Let's just leave it and keep trying doing what you're doing.
Do you ever just want to see the movie? I mean, something like Place Beyond the Pines?
Yeah, no, there's plenty of them. No, Place Beyond the Pines I have seen, because that was at Toronto. And, you know, everyone was there and sat down. And so, you know, you don't get up and... You know what I mean? Like, you're not, you don't be a dick about it, but, you know, I just don't, you know. Yeah.
So Mississippi Grind, what was the draw to that material?
I thought they wrote a really beautiful character. I mean, I just thought Jerry was really sad, really lovable, and just kind of made you go, oh, please don't do this. You know, please don't do this. Sort of like, you know, what to me sort of felt a little bit Rupert Pupkin, you know, the De Niro character in King of Comedy. You know, just like, I felt like he was someone, he made me uncomfortable, and I liked that. I thought it was beautifully written, and it was a chance to work with those guys, and a chance to do a lead in a, you know, an American film, and that was like, this is another no-brainer. I mean, Mississippi Grind for me was just a no-brainer, and I love that character. I think, you know, I think Jerry is, Jerry's a beautiful loser, you know? And he really is a beautiful loser.
Did you know Anna and Ryan's earlier work? Did you see their other films?
Yeah. No, I did. Yeah. And, you know, they, I'd worked with, you know, Ryan and stuff, so, Gosling, that is. Yeah, I was pretty excited about that. And then that was a long time before it came together. We met and, you know, talked about it, and then it didn't look like it might, you know, look like it might not come off. And then he came on his white charger, Ryan Reynolds, what a guy. And I'm immensely proud of Mississippi Grind. It's a genuine highlight of my working life.
So when it's a two-hander like that, does it change how you approach things, who the other hand is going to be, who the other person's going to be?
Yeah, well, yeah, absolutely. I mean, and in that case, it's just a case of finding the place between you both that is fun. And he's a very, you know, like, he's so easy to do that with. That guy is really gold, you know. He's got immense gifts, and I loved working with him. And he's a guy you love to be around. He's easygoing, he's charming, he has an incredibly fast wit. He's a joy to work with, you know, he is a joy to work with.
So when you're going into a character like that who is a loser, lovable often, but a loser nonetheless, are you there through the production of a film like that, or are you done your take and you're back to being you?
Oh, I see what you mean. I think that the way it happens, you know, character and is that before you're going into a film, you tend to try and feel where it lives within you, you know, and you play a lot of scenarios in your head. Because in a way, for an actor, the best bit about making stuff is when you first read the script. Because then it's like, oh, I'm going to go on a date here. You know, oh, this is, you know. And then when you're sort of thinking about it, you're doing it. But that's the intense period, I think, of trying to find the sense of where things live. And you might go to look at other movies. That's your sponging time. And then, you know, the rubber meets the road. And I think when the rubber meets the road, the best I think of it is you're just trying to offer up propositions in the take. You know, they're not definitive, and the whole idea of the, you know, character and stuff like that, I don't think of it like that so much anymore. I used to think of it a lot that way, but I don't think of it that way. I just think you try, you're offering up different propositions, and hopefully, as I said earlier, one of them, you know, has the good stuff in it, and that can be used.
But you're not carrying the weight of the world on your shoulders for that.
I'm trying not to. I mean, you know, I'm trying not to. I'm trying to listen more. You know, in scenes, I think that when you can hear the other actor talking to you and hear them, and just sort of let yourself respond in the, you know, in the situation that's going on. You tend to be able to ride through things a little bit easier.
Mm.
I mean, pressure's going to be there. You know, that's part of the deal. That's part of the, and you need it. You need it. I mean, that sort of first night nerves and the anxiety, they, you know, they're good things. They are actually your friend, even though they're a little bit daunting at times. But, yeah, I don't shirk them.
So are there any of your films where you go, oh, man, I just screwed that up. That's, I never found it. It never worked, or?
That's happened. Yeah. Yeah, that has happened. It hasn't happened. It hasn't happened recently, but yeah, I've had that. And I've also had, you know, experiences where for whatever reason, you feel like there's an opportunity there, or the opportunity that you were hoping might eventuate just didn't eventuate in the way you might have hoped. So, yeah, I think that's pretty normal. I mean, in a lot of ways, I think that being able to just keep going despite what you're... what you thought it was going to be like, or this or that, or the expectations you had, and being okay with, you know, not getting too hung up on stuff falling short of that or being different than that, but just keep trying to do that bit of it. Because in a lot of ways, you know, actors only have this tiny little bit of it to do. I mean, it gets us quite magnified in its sense because, you know, you watch the actors and most, you know, but we're really only doing a bit of what's going on. So that's the thing I was talking about earlier, being able to actually step into that framework and have the whole sort of thing travel along together. That's pretty cool.
Well, it's actually amazing when you think about it, how many pieces of the puzzle have to work.
Yeah, in order for everything to come together. Yeah. And, you know, and it's a phenomenal amount. It's a phenomenal amount. And the... You know, I'm just the production bit, really. A little bit of pre-production, but production, shooting, and then that's it. You know, I might do a voiceover line or whatever.
Right.
But, and so my kind of, what I kind of get really, you know, focused on and is just what it's like on at work.
So is going to an arc like Bloodline bit easier? Is it, does it seem familiar to you from your TV experience as a kid, or is that a bigger challenge?
I don't know. I don't think there's actually a huge difference between television and film, except for the speed at which you work. I mean, both of them involve, you got lights, you got the cameras, and, you know, you've got the microphones, and you've got the actors, and you're doing the scenes. Mm-hmm. So they're a lot closer, I think, than people think, but they're fast. And I think television gives you incredibly good muscles. It's really good for, if you're young and you're working in television, you'll learn a lot. But the great thing about Bloodline, from my perspective, was the creators, the Kessler brothers and Daniel Zellman, had said, look, we think we want to do this, and this is the area we want to check out, and this is the themes we're interested in. But they had a sense of not knowing as well. So there wasn't like this top-down heaviness about Bloodline, which made it actually feel like we were all on a journey. And that's not a burden. Bloodline went through a lot of phases in the production sense of it, and some of them were really difficult and trying, but, you know, that's often where, you know, good things happen from that too. And you know, you can have as bad a day as you like, but just don't leave as bad a film. You know, bad days are fine, but you know, putting in a bad performance is not. So you got to be able to adapt and deal with whatever all that stuff is.
So you didn't go into it knowing what your arc
was? No, I knew. No, absolutely not. No, I knew completely what the end was. That was the first thing that we had, you know, that was in the first conversations, because the, you know, the certain production parameters were, you know, discussed about from the outset. So, no, I mean, they knew what they were doing in an overarching sense, but they weren't sure as to how exactly they were going to, you know, they hadn't written it, and they didn't know quite where it would take them. They knew they were going to get here, and then they knew, you know, that the year after and the year after and the year after. I mean, they had that sense, but yeah.
So at this point, you have a, as you say, you're getting more opportunities to make choices. Do you know what choices you want to make? Do you have a plan? Are there things you want to get done that you're itching for?
You have plans all along the way. You know, you always have some sort of plan or some sort of hope. And yes, I still have a plan and I still have hope. And the degree to which, I'm able to sort of make that happen or, you know, we'll see. I'll let you know if it does happen.
But I mean, are you looking for, are there directors you're going, okay, that guy's my target or that's my, I want to do a musical or?
Yeah, no, there are definite things that I'm thinking about quite solidly and hoping that is where we might be going. They're not necessarily, I think, I think it's an interesting thing that is appealing to me at the moment, but you know, I'll as I say, I'll let you know if it happens. I'll tell you. But yeah.
And is acting the pleasure that it was intended to be for you? Is that?
Yeah, it's pretty good. The acting is generally really good. Sometimes it's a lot of energy to be in that kind of emotional state all day. And that's a challenging part of it, being in and out of that. But the actual acting, no, it's excellent. It's excellent. It's not the acting ever, I think, that is what is difficult for people in the job. It's the waiting. It's managing the waiting periods, you know, and even in the day, periods between when you get to do it again and you know, being able to ride on that roller coaster. Yeah.
Well, we're enjoying the ride, I think. Watching you is
fun. I mean, look, I'm having the time of my life. Absolutely. And I didn't expect that. I honestly had thought that, I mean, my expectations for what was going to lie ahead were, they weren't this. You know, they really weren't. They weren't this. And I am, I'm very grateful that things have taken the turn they have.
Yeah. Well, thank you for your time. Appreciate it.
Thank you
so much.
Lovely to talk to you.
And to you.